And then what happened?
Well, it got to where me and Skip couldn't communicate at all, just acted out roles. So I finally said, wow, there's got to be more to life than this. So I left to look for a community, I guess, a place to be artistic and a more religious feeling about life, somewhere to figure it all out.
Well, it's just transcendental. The thing happened to us. Only it took me 4 marriages and 13 years of communal living before I finally figured out the basic issue.
The basic issue?
You mean that it all boils down to penises and vaginas?
Precisely.
I already told you I don't want to do a couple trip again.
You do want stability.
Yes.
Then the next question is, how do you get variety plus stability?
All right, lay it on me.
By being in a lifetime group with a rotational sleeping schedule, say, sleep different one of your partners each night in a continuous cycle.
Well, I suppose that's a very logical way to go about it.
Greatest discovery since the wheel. I've had the fantasy for the longest time of sleeping with a bevy of beautiful women. Women who were so liberated and so intelligent that they could live together and sleep with the same men without being jealous.
Why commit yourself to falling in love just once if you can do it over and over again?
When I left Georgia and went to New York, I was very firmly rooted in the idea of wanting a wholesome family life. But I had this pull. I wanted to sleep with a lot of men. I can remember that when I left and was living there working in New York. And I didn't know how to reconcile those two things until I got here, and I began to see that you could reconcile the idea of variety and intimacy with a wholesome family, that it really fit together.
Well, I tell you, it wasn't that easy for me. I went back and forth on polyfidelity, promiscuity, monogamy. I was a torn again Kerista. And then I think one of the big things that eventually swung me over was realizing the limits that monogamy has on it, and that it didn't give me the security to talk about all my paranoias and my fears and all that stuff you've got from your childhood and your parents did this and that. And polyfidelity gives me a security where I feel like I can open up and I can just talk about all that stuff.
So I remember when the word polyfidelity was born a few years ago. It was about 4 or 5 years ago, and there were only 4 of us back then, and we had described ourselves as being non-monogamous for years. And we were sitting around in the waterbed, or in one of the rooms in one of our houses on Schrader Street, and 4 of us were trying to think of a way to describe ourselves positively, and we were thinking of words, and we came up with the word multi-fidelity. And we thought about it for a while. Anyway, out of it evolved eventually the concept of polyfidelity, or the actual verbal description, polyfidelity, which described perfectly what we were into, what we had all been looking for, which was a family structure which blended together the concept of a morality connected with fidelity and the idea of best friendships, that you didn't have to cut off your friendships at one other person, but you experienced variety and intimacy as well.
One of the questions that Phil Donahue asked me was whether or not I get jealous. And specifically, he said, do you get jealous on those nights where Eve was sleeping with one of the other men? And I said that no, I did not feel jealous because I had an equality with the other men. And also, I felt that I had my own personality, my own charm. And I didn't have to worry about outperforming anyone else, that I had to really do it myself. And that's the way it was with all the men and with all the women in the group.
When I think about it, it all boils down to something I said rather spontaneously in one of the first visits to Kerista Village. And that was the question of, what do I really want? And I answered that saying, I want good sex and long-lasting love. And that's why I joined.
Those are good reasons.
I would die for that.
In Kerista Village, best friendships are really important. The friendships are seen as the biggest. We've created the balanced rotational sleeping cycle to encourage non-preferentiality. It's just an allotted amount of time for people to spend together. People have sex, they like having sex, but it's not a requirement.
for having tuna fish, eggs, salad.
Well, about house cleaning and chores, our motto is, if it ain't fun, it won't get done. So if it doesn't get done, we just call a work bee. We play loud music, we vacuum the floors and dust and wash the dishes, and it all gets taken care of. Every Monday night we get together for our Monday night services. It's where we talk about our recent theories, our ideas, catching each other up on what's happening with the children. It's like the heartbeat of our community.
Before I got to California, I was planning to go to college, and as far as I knew, I would just do the routine thing of go to college and find a career in art and go on to get married. But I decided I would make a trip hitchhiking around with one of my friends. While I was camping on the beach, I heard about this town in Vermont where everybody lived in a commune, or different communes, and I thought, wow, that is really great. Contrasted to the college scene, it was really exciting to me because I guess I got a sense that what I wanted was a way to learn experientially about living, about relationships.
When I first got that letter from Eve, it had this flyer in it that she had designed, and it said that there were a group of people who were going to be living together to build a model community which was into non-jealousy and total equality, and that all the people were artists and it was going to be completely non-commercial. We were just going to be performing for each other and make life a party all the time. And I thought, wow, this is really a Woodstock Nation rap.
Wow, what's that?
The psychosocial frontier. It's an undiscovered territory.
That's it. That's got to be it. The place where I can find my instincts. The righteous heart.
The past can't limit us out there. It's all new rules. We can test how close groups of humans can get.
I always knew I would draw comics someday. I was looking for a way to stay excited and stay stimulated with my life. Kerista Village had to be created because I was just too lonely and too bored to be satisfied. Polyfidelity is the cornerstone of the family system. It combines the best features of traditional family systems and a more open, loose lifestyle. Polyfidelity exists inside of the BFIC. The BFIC is a best friend identity cluster, a group of best friends who have made an intentional commitment to each other, which should last a lifetime, around their ideals, around raising children together. There was a time in my life where I've seriously considered not ever having any children myself. Every child-rearing system that I saw had so many problems in it. The children were neurotic, the adults were neurotic. Multiple parenting in cooperative living was a very obvious solution. It works for the children because they have the advantages of having a lot of role models, a lot of people to hang out with them, to teach them a lot of personalities, a whole range of fun that comes with having a lot of people who are really involved with you. They also get the benefits of not having frustrated parents, which is where it benefits the parents, because alone having to raise children or with one other person, you're bound to run out of patience, you're bound to get frustrated, you're bound to run into situations that are very hard to figure out what to do on your own. In multiple parenting, where it's shared, you get all of the joys and very few of the hardships.
Our average income remaining per person per month is still running around $200. And if we were twice as large as we were now, in other words, 35 adults, we would end up having $7,000 per month free and above all of our expenses to develop an eco-village. And the plan would be that we could then have plenty of money for materials and also to support a crew of four or five people who could develop them. First one, and then, as you see down here, a network of eco-villages up and down the coast, which would then work as a survival network in case of thermonuclear war. Now, the rural eco-village would be comprised of a total giant educational child care community. And with the full-time construction crew that would be supported by those of us doing income-generating activities here. Naturally, no eco-village would be complete without hot tubs, solar heated, hot baths for everyone, the Greek utopian ideal, food self-sufficiency, That's Cap's department, I guess, so far. An electrical music system for our dances. Fish farming and aquaculture. And then there'd be just a whole host of other goodies that we can come up with in our imaginations. But it's just nice to get the visual, and it's really within our reach. All we need is about twice as many people. Come on. Let's see how fast we can do it.
Before I got in this community, all the other attempts at community kept falling apart. We were always something magical, money management that would take care of itself. We used to keep our money in a giant earthenware jug because nobody knew anything about bookkeeping. Nobody knew anything about the importance of keeping accounts. We never could conceive of ourselves fitting into the establishment with non-profit corporations and profit corporations. I'm just delighted to see how much structure we have come up with, and yet I don't think we have any superfluous structure. Contract that defines our behavior with very clear-cut precision. We have agreed on about 300 different points of behavior. For example, we have agreed not to ever raise our voice in anger. We've also agreed not to have any sexual relations with anybody outside of the community. We've all agreed to live by clear-cut, definable standards. Everyone in the community works. People can work inside the community or they can work outside the community. For example, one of us owns a share in the New Yellow Cab Co-op. We actually have three collectives. One is the house cleaning collective. People go out in pairs, so there's fun in it. Then we have the gardening collective, which was built from the ground up. Everybody generates income, either through collectives or by going out and working at a job. Everybody supports themselves. There's a lot of money left over at the end of the month that flows into a general fund, and that's called surplus income sharing.
I work as an auditor for an agency of the federal government. Polyfidelity enables me to have more fun sexually because I'm sleeping with a variety of women, and it also provides a greater amount of intellectual stimulation because a greater number of women provide more ideas and more stimulating subjects to talk about. One of the things I do in my time is make films, and a film I'm working on right now has to do with the subject of multiple parenting in Kerista Village. Surplus income sharing has enabled our community to purchase a film editor, which I would have never been able to purchase on my own as an individual.
Hi, everybody.
Communicating our ideas to the general public takes many different forms. We do live theater, conduct seminar programs, and we even operate a university which offers a number of courses.
This is self-explanatory.
Paper is very popular because it covers many subjects. Healthcare, environmental issues, alternative technology.
I think he wants you to go over this.
Our magazine, Utopian Eyes, conveys to our readers the optimism that group marriage is a viable alternative, and it is succeeding in San Francisco. Many of the articles are about what is going on in the personal lives of individual members, the types of growth and change that they're going through psychologically and emotionally. A very successful feature that we've had in the magazine has been a comic strip, which contains the characters of Kerista Village.
And then this we have.
Each one of us writes for the publication, and there's a specific team of people that have the responsibility of actually doing the production and getting it on the street.
Then we have about five different pieces of art that have to get pulled. You know, and I was just thinking about that that great line from Citizen Kane. Do you remember it?
Rosebuds.
No, he's 19 and he says, I think it would be great to run a newspaper.
Our publications are distributed free of charge throughout the Bay Area through 450 different stores and also through newspaper boxes.
Is that us?
Yes. There we are.
Look, we have twice as many people as anybody else.
We have our own videotape equipment. We make learning programs for our own children, and we also like to document the changes and the things that are going on inside of our own community.
Then we got hung up on the rock.
Well, we've talked about
Gestaltorama is the lifeblood of Kerista Village. It is the mental health process which enables members to break free of their neurotic conditioning. Everyone is expected to be very talkative, and everyone is expected to talk about what they're doing and how they feel about what they're doing. If people are not participating verbally, we take that to mean that they're not interested in working on themselves, and that would mean that they should be somewhere else.
Sometimes she's so beautiful that the inner beauty comes out of her, and her face is radiant. But then I think she catches herself and says, oh, no, you're not going to get me in bed with that old man. Oh, no.
Well, she could be. She's just having trouble with platonic friendship.
Right. Well, that means she's into romance. Then she's got to be into romance.
I think Fur is into total
negative romance.
She thinks that that Judd wants her in bed, and that there's this whole negative interaction. Because the way she just said, well, you're not going to get me, ha, ha, ha. And I think that she's into a thing where she thinks she's more desirable than other people and that everybody's just waiting to seduce her into a B-fit.
She acts like she's in a rut a lot of times. She has no flexibility.
She hasn't made up her mind that this community is her baby. She just hasn't made up that mind. If she had a child, she would nurture that child from morning till night. She does not nurture this community with love. Maybe she doesn't see this community as an organic entity.
I agree that that's in there, but I think that part of what happens in the way people get personality alignment is that when we first met her, there were maybe 90 of her personalities or 90% of her personalities didn't want to be here and 10% of her personalities wanted to be here. And
but wait, she's not using retrospective consciousness. The disease in this community is that the sickness is that there are some people here who still do not believe in shared leadership. Deep down, it's not enough escape velocity from the conditioning that, oh no, you've got to have leaders, you've got to have leaders, you can't have a community without leaders. Okay, you've got to have leadership, but the leadership does not have to be vested in a leader. That's where the mistake is. The administrative capability for a group of people to manage their money collectively is simply a matter of relegating the authority to the majority decision-making process, right? But from that point on, everybody here has to grab as much leadership as they can and look for opportunities to grab leadership. Instead of taking the attitude, oh, me, I'm just a working slob. I hope they don't think of more things for me to do.
Sometimes when we get into these gestalts with you, Fur, I get the sense that you lose the real basic sense of what Gestaltorama is all about. And I think that unless you can depend on us as friends to show you, to reflect back to you your own behavior so that you can see that when you're obnoxious, you're really being obnoxious and it affects us, unless you can get a sense objectively of your own behavior, you're never going to be able to transcend these things.
I don't feel like I'm being catatonic. I feel like I'm just trying to absorb what everybody's saying so that I won't be around my behavior. And I do think that I have a personality that says flip things, and because I said I thought that Judd always went over his time limit, I don't think that he always goes over his time limit. I think he does occasionally, which is no big deal, because it's something that he's working on, and I think that it was a flip thing to say. I think that the work that I do is fine. I don't want to give up any of it. I think that vocationally I'm happy where I am. And it is a personality that I would like to retire, definitely.
One of our big discoveries in utopian psychology is that each of us has many personalities which manifest themselves at different times. Tonight, we're going to take a peek at some of our negative personalities, some of which we have already eliminated and some of which we're still trying to get rid of. Friends, we present the retirement home for unwanted personalities.
Next. Name, please?
Miss Persnickety.
Your occupation?
Disciplinarian.
Discipline, very vanguard.
Don't get fresh with me, young lady.
Oh, okay. Your former employer.
Fur, that irresponsible hedonist. I don't know what she's going to do without me to control her carnal desire. She's going to burn in the fires of hell with her orgasmic passions. She's going to end up unwanted, unloved, unmarried, and unequivocally unemployed.
All right. over to the right there? Thank you. Okay, next. Hi.
How are you doing?
Name?
Hate the state.
Hate the state.
That's right.
Okay. Your occupation, please?
Well, I got a master's in revolution, and then I was going to PhD in disruption. But the war ended, school became a bore, and I just split.
Uh-huh, okay. Your former employer?
Buff. That middle-class bourgeois sellout pig. Revisionist reactionary. He makes me sick.
Okay, could you please go out and turn to the right?
To the right? Are you kidding?
Everybody heard for saying, yeah, I acknowledge I did something I shouldn't have done, but I don't think anybody got a real sense of remorse or this an idea that Fur had an emotional connect to what it was that she was acknowledging. That she does that characteristically in her gestalt, where she says, yeah, well, it was creepy growing from it, but you don't really get a sense that it's getting through. And that's the part of her that seems maybe like she's caught up in it, because I don't know if you can get beyond it unless you really let it sink in and really are able to express it when it's sinking in.
Yeah, I would have liked to see Fur directly answer Judd on his group about that she doesn't want to be with old people, with old men, and that particular riff, I think would have been good to reassure Judd at that point from, you know, what
she
I know
really
about
the She didn't
really
answer any of the charges. Yeah. Interesting is first going into it again. Here we are all talking about Fur, and Fur is just being catatonic again, and it's very characteristic. Everybody always has to answer as a third person.
Yeah, I don't feel like I'm being catatonic. I think I was just listening to what was being said, and I didn't mean not answer Judd when he was talking yesterday. I think the conversation was just going on, and I was trying to absorb everything that everybody was saying, and I mean, I think that I do feel bad about it, about what happened. I think that's probably some of the reason why it's hard to hear about it, is that you don't like the negative behavior that you're into, and so you don't, it's kind of like you don't want to feel bad about it, so you kind of don't want to hear so much about it either, but I think that's part of defensiveness too.
So you feel like you're in defensiveness now or in this last part of this conversation?
Well, according to the definition, I'd have to say yes, although I feel like I'm just trying to be calm about listening to what everybody has to say, and it's not something that I want to be into, definitely not.
I just know we're all such strong individuals. I can't imagine any one of us into the community. Something wasn't holding true to our conscience, and I think that's where our individual comes in. And it's definitely not a conflict of interest with the community. It's just a question of knowing where your boundaries are and where your integrity is.
Rather than losing your individuality, the only way you can actually function in a really together group of people that is tight is having a very strong independence, a very strong ego, because you have to be able to maintain your own identity amidst all the other strong egos, if it's going to be equal, if you're going to be able to play as an equal and have the most fun.
So now that you've been finishing filming this movie, do you have any impressions, questions?
Well, I was interested in the whole concept of polyfidelity, and I don't know how I would personally feel in my sex life regimented, you know. And I was wondering how the two of you feel about it. You're sleeping with three different men, and you're sleeping with how many different women?
Five.
Mm-hmm. What if you want to sleep with one woman one night and another woman another night? I don't want to sleep with the person who's been assigned. What happens then? Does that...
Well, it's not a matter of... I'm already out saying out front that I have an equal amount of love for all women in my family. So it's just a matter of setting up a system that I really don't have to put that much psychic energy into thinking about, because I'm already saying out front I have an equal amount of love.
Well, look, you're around us. Which one of us do you think he likes better?
Right. But I make my decision every night. I mean, would we play footsies underneath the table?
I find it hard making a decision, too, I guess.
Yeah, but your life would be regimented, too. There's one.
I mean, I don't see how you could have the same kind of feeling for one person as you do.
No, it's very different. It's true.
And different moods, right? Supposing my mood one night was to be with you, but I was assigned, I say assigned, you'll have to excuse it.
It is a stupid word.
Okay, well, it's obviously you have a structure, you have a certain model to, you know, enhances, which creates the culture that you're in. I understand that. But,
no, it's a balanced rotational sleeping cycle.
Right.
Based on the fact that you want to sleep with each of the people in your family. Like, let's say one night I was supposed to be so, and he announced that he didn't want to sleep with me. Well, I would certainly want to know that, because if that was the case, then I would say, okay, I don't want to be in a family with Ozzo, because I'm convinced that there are 12 seats on the bus and that there are 12 men out there who sleeping with me is going to be heaven.
Morality that holds that marriage has the monopoly on respectability, the new morality that's everywhere, that we're just one part of, breaks down that monopoly. And I think that what we're talking about is extending social tolerance to any lifestyle where adults are involved in mutual consent. And social tolerance is really all that we're expecting for our lifestyle. I think that's our basic message.
We can share our money with the active money. We can feel the laughter without leaving after home. Is where the heart lies and freedom flies. Open eyes, I've seen the light inside. Uh-huh. Do you want to fly, really, really fly? Do you want to fly so high up in the sky? Like birds of a feather, we will flock together freely. Tribal rhythm, take me over. I'm in clover, you love celebration. Psychic transportation, take me to the high San Francisco night. Shine like northern lights ablaze with pure delight.
Mythology begins with a planet called Heaven, which exists in a whole different universe from our own. We know about Heaven because of a very special communication system that beams messages back and forth through the black hole which connects the two universes. Life on Heaven is really heavenly, and so some of the people there are trying to communicate the image of what it's like to some of the people here on Earth. That way a model of Heaven can be built on Earth. The people they've picked to receive their messages are the Kerista monks living on Earth in the present. These monks are connected on a timeline to future Kerista monks living on space colonies. All of the Keristas of Earth, the ones in the present and the ones in the future, beam in telepathically to Sister Kerista and her family on Heaven. They use prayer and group mind techniques to send their messages back and forth through the black hole, which the people of Heaven think of as a psychedelic hole. Sister Kerista and her holy family receive the messages in their headquarters, which is set up in a little village called Enough. Kerista's village, Enough, is a fairly average sort of village, as heavenly villages go. It's strategically located in a very comfortable spot, a little bit beyond insufficient and just this side of too far. Of course, the people of Enough don't spend all their time there, because like all the inhabitants of Heaven, they love to travel and they have good friends to visit in many other villages. People on Heaven also really love trees, and many of their houses are built in the woods on the outskirts of the village. A lot of the houses are built up in the branches of trees or the bottoms of the biggest trees. Enough is a place in the forest of thought, on the planet Heaven, where Kerista lives. Kerista's Beefik is called the Holy Family. Each member of the Holy Family has her or his own individual symbol. The members of the Holy Family are also sometimes called the Sacred Names. The symbol of Sister Kerista, founder of the Holy Beefik, is a set of sculptor's tools. This symbol fits her very well, because Kerista inspires much art in her earthly tribespeople and is the chief agent in promoting culture sculpture which transforms life on Earth. This is the story of Sister Kerista.
Here I am, Heaven's child. The pleasures of the swamp. I'm drinking out in a sacred thought spot called Dambala's Cove. Dambala, you see, has to do with evolution, which is the mechanical, unfolding, and predetermined plan. Dambala is the spirit of Ibolele, which is wood, and the spirit of all these fine creatures here. Ooh, Dambala is the spirit of nature. The forest of thought is a groovy scene where the sock trees grow red, blue, and green. Do you ever wonder where your lost socks go? From the washer and the dryer through the psychedelic hole. When it's warm on Heaven, we wear a few clothes, but rainbow socks adorn our toes. This is a treehouse, Heaven style. On a pad of moss, I've slept a while. In my sleep, I dreamt of Earth and people destined to give birth to utopian paradise here at last. You tribal playmates are best. On Heaven, we don't know it all. We're just plain folks on whom you can call. 'Cause in the future time we live and have some overview to give. It's in the plan, so have no fear, 'cause we're already living here. Our houses in the trees around the village center, but we like to do a lot of walking, and we come together regularly to do a little working, taking care of business, and a lot of playing. We like those hip mottos they got down there on Earth. If it ain't fun, it won't get done. And never do today what you can put off till tomorrow. That's me sitting there playing with one of the local fuzzle cuzzles that live beneath the giant mushrooms. Those are the people are the rest of my family, the ones I growed up with.
Children on Heaven are trained from the earliest age to be on the lookout for a sign or a message that will tell them what their mission in life is meant to be. Usually this happens between the ages of 4 and 8. When Kerista was 8 years old, she received her very first telepathic message, which told her that her mission in life concerned the planet Earth. Her role was to be quite momentous. Goddess of a new religion.
Wow! Something just hit me in my telepathic receptor. It seems like it's coming from the psychedelic hole, from another universe. Maybe it's that place I used to dream about when I was little. Earth? You all are real? A real audience sitting there looking at me? Wow, what a role I've been picked for. I can't say I'm not surprised, but on the other hand, why not? Here I am, preparing for the theophany experience. A goddess must stay in shape, you know, physically and spiritually. Coming through to all of you in the spirit of HPA, healthy physical activity. And you know all about this number here on my jersey. Number 12, ooh, that's a fine number. And remember, chillins, a toad out a day keeps them voices away.
August 15th, 1956. Brother Jed hears a chorus of male voices conducted by Sister Kerista, telling him he is the prophet of Kerista, the next great religion of the world.
stay with me now. I'm about to beam a holographic image of myself on down to Earth so I can get one of my artists on the right track. She's out camping in the woods and can't quite get to sleep.
Uh-huh. This is a west wind. Must be old Zeph getting through to us. People must have first personified the spirits of nature, wind, sun, water, and later on things like virtues, values, ideas. Yeah, like war, jealousy, justice, wisdom, love. I guess Jesus was a god of compassion. Hey, you know what? I can't remember ever hearing about a god of humor. You're right. How dreadful. No wonder the world's in such a mess. We better invent one. Why a god? Why not a goddess? Wait a minute. This might be the perfect role for Sister Atsarek. Yipes! What's that? Holy cow, it's her!
Hiya, Paul. I've been waiting in the wings for the right moment to make my appearance. I knew you'd come around to seeing what a handy-dandy deity I am sooner or later.
Are you really Sister Atsarek?
Looking at you. But call me Sister Kerista. That's Atsarek backwards. It's got more class.
No, I meant, are you a real goddess or are we just imagining you?
Yes. What's the difference? Sure, us deities are human inventions, but then again, from a bigger perspective, invented deities are a part of the cosmos program, just as much as people are.
You mean there's a higher scheme of things that invented us both?
Now you're getting it, so we're about equal that way. But let me tell you, for figments of your imagination, we deities sure do pack one hell of a lot of clout. Once you set us free, we have more power than any other invention ever made.
Set you free? From what?
From anonymity. Listen, don't you know what you got picked to do this utopian religion gig for?
Who, me?
I ain't talking to no tree spirit, child.
Oh, well, no, why?
Stick out your right hand, Sister Polly. Okay. Now, what fits that hand better than the slickest glove in the world?
My pen?
Good, good. Now, let's look at that match made in heaven. Beautiful. You've heard that saying that the pen is mightier than the sword?
Yeah, uh-huh.
And that one picture is worth 1,000 words?
Yes.
So put them together, and what have you got?
You get the power of the comic strip?
Now you're cooking. And guess what's my greatest ambition in life?
To liberate humanity from oppression?
Well, sure, that's part of it, but that's not exactly what I had in mind.
What is it then?
To be a character in your comic strip, silly. Don't you see? If we team up, I could be bigger than Superman, bigger than Mickey Mouse.
Wow. What a thought.
So the next...
Hold on a minute. I mean, I don't even...